Please welcome Senior Vice President and General Manager of the Infrastructure and Security Group at Cisco, Tom Gillis, and Senior Vice President and General Manager, Security Products Splunk, a Cisco company, Mike Horn.
Morning, everyone. I'm Tom Gillis. I'm the General Manager for Infrastructure and Security at Cisco.
And I'm Mike Horn, the General Manager for Security Products at Splunk.
So, Mike, we've known each other for a long time. We're finally working together.
Yeah, Tom, all it took was Cisco acquiring Splunk to make it happen.
Small acquisition, but here we are. So in our new roles, you know, one of the things that is, I think, wonderful is we get to spend time thinking about how can a leader in infrastructure and a leader in security analytics work together to define what I think is going to be a blueprint for a new security architecture.
Absolutely.
And, you know, there are some major trends that we see happening in the industry that really require this new blueprint. So I've been coming to the show for many, many years, as you have too, Mike, right? And we don't like to count, but fingers and toes, you know what I mean? Like many, many years, every single year, we hear the same thing. Threat landscape is getting more severe, more sophisticated techniques. I'm going to argue that this year was a bit different. This year, we saw some trends, which are really kind of disturbing. This year, we saw attacks against a new attack surface. Switches, routers, firewalls themselves are being attacked. And the goal of the attackers is not to steal credit card information, not to steal the secret formula for Coke. The goal of the attackers is to get in and stay in, so they could turn the lights out when the time comes. So the stakes are pretty high, right? Security has always mattered, but it matters more now than ever. The second big trend is the onset of artificial intelligence. And we talked about this with G2's keynote on day one. AI is changing all the fundamental things about an application, right? It's changing all the things around us at a breakneck speed. Let's look into what's driving that change. So if you think about an application in very simplistic terms, there used to be three pieces: presentation layer, the app layer, and the data layer. Okay? Now with an AI-based application, we're introducing a new layer, the model. And there's two things about a model that are going to create really unique security challenges. The first is, when a model takes that data and it learns something, model never forgets, right? This is a problem from a security standpoint, because it knows all your secrets. And now the second thing about this is that a model is non-deterministic or kind of unpredictable. And so an attacker could trick a model into revealing those secrets that it knows. So this creates a whole new challenge for security. The second thing is just pure scale. The scale at which these applications operate at is unprecedented. At Cisco, we make chips for the largest AI factories in the world, and these chips run an astounding 800 gigabits per second, which seems like a gigantic amount. But because the processor of AI apps is parallel, a GPU, it's not enough, right? So each time Moore's law clicks, these things get faster and they get wider. So the amount of data that an AI-based application can produce, consume, and generate that we have to wrap security around, it's like an order of magnitude greater data. And I'll argue, Mike, that the traditional security architecture is just not set up to scale in this post-AI world.
Yeah, that's right, Tom. So when I think about a common theme for current security architectures, a lot of that has to do with centralizing. How do I bring things to one place? And that could be on the firewall and creating DMZs and egress points. That's also in things like data logging. You know, I come from Splunk, and we've got a lot of people that are bringing a ton of security data into their SIM. But there's also still blind spots from a an attacker and a defender perspective.
Yeah, let's pick on that a little bit. So Zero Trust says, in this world of mobile devices and distributed endpoints, things are all over the place, you have to assume that that endpoint is compromised, right? And these days, it's a pretty good assumption. So the whole goal of security is, how do we identify lateral movement? Lateral movement, by definition, happens where, Mike?
I hope this is not a trick question, Tom, but I think it happens in the network.
It happens in the network, right? So it's more than likely that we can see the lateral movement of an attacker, but the vast majority of this data is untapped because it's just simply too large to see, right? We haven't been able to bring that into that centralized architecture that Mike was talking about. And I think this sets the stage for a new approach to how we think about security.
Absolutely. And so when we think about the need for a new architecture and the driver, you know, AI is accelerating the pace of so many different things, both from a defender and an attacker perspective. And so, you know, the time for this is now, Tom.
Yeah.
This is not, you know, 12, 18, you know, 5 years from now. We're really talking about what's happening today.
So what's it look like, Mike?
Yeah, so in this architecture, you really need three key things. And so the first is to be able to distribute your data storage across multiple different data stores. We'll talk about that. The next piece is being able to distribute your data analytics that runs across those data stores. And then the final pillar is really around how do you do distributed enforcement. So let's take a closer look at that first one, Tom, you know, this distributed data storage. And in the distributed data storage, you know, one of the things that we see a lot of, and we don't see every single firewall log, but we see a lot of firewall logs. And so let's talk about what that looks like in this future architecture.
Imagine we could take those firewalls, define them in software, and break them into lots of little pieces so that we could look at each one of those east-west traffic flows, but we want to look at it in great detail. Because in this world that you talked about earlier, Mike, of stolen credentials and compromised machines, attackers, they've got a password, right? So they're just logging in. So in order to identify friend from foe, you really need to look at the process level. I want to see every single machine, and I want to see what process on that machine, even if it has a legitimate credential, what process initiates the flow and what process terminates that flow on the server side. And so the good news is we can see that data. That's the good news. The bad news is that is three orders of magnitude more data than we're ingesting today with firewall logs.
Yeah, that's right.
1,000x, right? So it is simply not practical to put all this stuff in one monster data lake.
Right, yeah. The days of one security data lake to rule them all is, I think, you know, challenged in terms of just the volume. And when you think about the distribution of data, so if you have things that are originating in one or more cloud service providers, you know, moving that data between service providers becomes very expensive and cumbersome. And so what we believe is in this new architecture is you need a multiple data lakes, data ponds, data puddles. You're gonna have data across lots of different, yeah. We got a fan of, I'm not sure if it was the data puddles or what they were a fan of, but we got a fan of that. And to make that happen, to make that a reality, Tom, you need this technology, this technique called federation.
Yes.
You know, federation is all about how do I look across multiple different things, but provide that insight from a single location.
Right. It's no longer about ingest. Leave the data in place where the data lives and have the ability to search across it. And Mike, as you said, there are this notion of data lakes, which maybe there's five, right? So maybe a firewall console that has those firewall logs, instead of trying to ingest that stuff, you leave it in place, but you can search across it with federation. But Mike talked about data puddles, and so the devices themselves, as they get smarter, they can actually process this information in very, very fine-grained detail. So what we're talking about, Mike, is a blueprint that may take years to fully mature, but we can start by going from one data lake to four data ponds to eventually hundreds or maybe even thousands of these little tiny data repositories, all controlled by one central analytics platform.
That's right. And so then when we look at, you know, the next piece of this, it really is around that data analytics that Tom mentioned. And the key word here is this distributed notion. So if you think about, you know, data analytics and data are kind of two sides of the same coin. You need those analytics to run close to where the data is. And in the old, you know, current times, you would say, hey, okay, I'm going to bring all that to my SIM. I'm going to try to have this in analytics run in one place. But when you think about, you know, this new world where we're talking about federation and the ability to distribute data across a whole wide range of different data stores, you need that analytics layer to follow where the data is. And let's talk a little bit about some of the places that can happen.
Well, I think what's exciting about this is that applications are moving outside the data center. And AI is fueling that. So AI is going to run applications in the world around us. And it's just not practical to ingest all that data into one monster data lake to try to like be able to see with the resolution and granularity that we think we need to. So moving the data analytics close to the source of the data, this is the architecture for the future, and I think it's very, very powerful.
Yeah, and then you know, the third pillar of this new architecture is really around how do we distribute the data enforcement. So we've got this insight that's been generated from these distributed data stores, the analytics that are running in a distributed way across those things, but now I need to do things like containment actions, or I want to be able to do micro policy enforcement. So Tom, let's talk about what's happening in that space.
Yeah, having the ability to distribute policy enforcement makes it much more granular and much more powerful. And this is already happening in the firewall space. So Gartner talks about the hybrid mesh firewall. And the principle here is that you have a single management plane, and you can implement it in a traditional firewall appliance like we know and love. You can do it in a software version of that, a virtual firewall, which is kind of the same, but it's a little more flexible. It gets more interesting when you can put these controls directly into the host using a technology called eBPF, and we're going to talk a lot more about that in a different forum. But I think the most interesting form factor is when you can actually put security intelligence into the fabric of the network itself. And this is a class of device that we call a smart switch. So Mike, let's drill down a little bit more on what is a smart switch and why is this special? Imagine if we could have a single device that had two personalities. One personality is going to be network processing. The other personality is security processing that can be accelerated by a chip called the DPU, Data Processing Unit. And these are actually mature chips that have been around for 10 years or so. And you can think of it as a little tiny baby firewall on a chip. So these two devices that are living in a single package, they have two very different personalities. Mike, if you think about how often you want to update your security algorithms, it's pretty frequently.
Yeah, right? Exactly. The landscape is, as we were talking earlier, moving quickly, and you want to be able to adapt and catch up with that very fast.
Changing all the time.
That's right.
How often do you want to update your network processor?
As little as possible. If I can set it and forget it. And,
never.
And,
right?
Exactly.
Customers will be like, I want to update that every 10 years. And so you know, we need to do a little better than that. But the idea is we can bring these two personalities together into a single device. And that brings security and network together in a way that has really never been done before. So the network processor can do what it's good at, which is move packets as fast and reliably from point A to point B. The security processor, in this case it's a DPU, is going to be looking at those packets and saying, let's identify friend from foe. Right? Let's look at that east-west traffic pattern in very fine-grained detail and figure out good from bad. But this architecture is not limited to a DPU. Right? In the next generation of these devices, you're going to see not just a DPU, but a GPU. And this is going to allow us to put logic or reasoning into this distributed system. And this is going to be super important in a world of AI-based applications, like we talked about in G2's keynote on day one. So in a traditional application, you could think of the security model as looking at every question-answer pair in isolation. So can I have Tom's social security number? In this case, the application says yes. I would rather have said no, but like you can look at each transaction individually. When we move to this AI-based world, remember I talked about the model, it knows all your secrets? When you were a kid, do you remember playing the game 20 questions, Mike?
Yep, 20 questions? Absolutely.
So if I've got a secret, can Mike guess that question in 20, find my secret in 20 questions?
Tom, I've known you a long time, so I'm thinking maybe I can do it in 10, but I'm going to give one guess. Is it your social security number?
Yeah, okay, so we got it in one question. So I'm a terrible poker player. Maybe it's three. Point is, an adversary is playing 20 questions to try to trick these models into revealing those secrets. And we need to be able to look at this with logic, right, with reasoning, and say, does this make sense? So these are the security controls that will be necessary for the post-AI world. But this distributed architecture also has benefits for maybe a more mundane, but I'm going to argue very, very urgent problem, which is how do we manage vulnerabilities? And Mike, what do you see happening in that space?
Yeah, one of the things, again, when we talk about that whole acceleration, it used to be from the time a vulnerability was published till you saw an exploit in the wild, that could take sometimes months to show up. And now what we're seeing is, you know, attackers are weaponizing these things so much faster. You might have a vulnerability that gets announced, and then a day later, even hours later, Tom, you'll see exploits happening in the wild. Yep. And I don't know about you, but I don't know too many security teams that can patch their servers a couple hours after a vulnerability gets announced.
Thousands of applications can be patched in 4 hours. It's just not practical, right? And so we need to take a different approach here. So with this distributed architecture, we have the granularity to apply a compensating control underneath that vulnerability in a very, very automated way. And Mike, one of the things I think is interesting about this is it's not just about 0 days, right? You're seeing the same thing. The drop-off in zero-day activity, it's slowed way down.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. And so I was reviewing a report from our incident response team recently. They showed the top 10 vulnerabilities that were being exploited. Guess what was on that list? Mike, can you guess? 20 questions?
I got my 20 questions again. Yeah. All right. Well, yeah, I'm going to say log4j.
Yeah. Again, he knows all the
answers. I got the
cheat. So he got it in one question. Yes, log4j. 5 years later, half a decade later, we see activity around exploiting log4j. The point of this, patching is hard. Let's accept that. Having the ability to apply compensating controls to both traditional applications as well as these new AI-based applications, we think this is going to be a really, really transformative capability. And it wasn't possible without the distributed architecture and the AI to manage all this stuff. So AI is changing how we do security in our own world, in our own applications, But as we move into this world of AI-based applications, you know, where's it all going?
That's right. Yeah, we're seeing AI shift from just being in, you know, these software applications to now showing up in the physical world. And that's, you know, the operating room, the manufacturing floor, oil rigs, et cetera. And Tom, I know that you have a particular interest in AI and the physical world.
I do. Mike knows a little bit too much about my personal hobbies, but like I have dedicated a huge chunk of my life to the latest in beer drinking technology. And AI is revolutionizing that. So a big problem I have is if I want a beer and I want to share a beer with Mike, I got to get up and go to the fridge. What a burden, right? Imagine if AI could power a little robot that would actually bring us it's only 10 a.m., right? So non-alcoholic beers. Well, what we're looking at is the AI bot, R2D bot. And look at this, we've got two icy cold non-alcoholic beers.
Nondescript beers as well, Tom.
Yep. So thank you.
Tom, I thought it would have been bigger.
Well, okay, Mike, the truth is, when I was describing this to the engineers, I said 6 feet, but I wrote it on a cocktail napkin, and I put two little hash marks there, and so they made a 6-inch robot. I guess this is my Spinal Tap moment.
Okay. But, cocktail napkin.
A little underwhelming.
Okay.
But the point is, AI is going to be showing up in the real world in ways that was never possible before, and we need to make sure that that AI bot can bring us an ice-cold non-alcoholic beer, but not try to break my leg because I'm making dumb jokes, right? And so the network is the perfect platform for delivering these type of advanced security controls. So AI is going to change the applications, but in my opinion, the biggest and probably most immediate impact that AI is having is on the security operations team. Mike, what's happening?
Yeah, Tom. I've worked in building tools and solutions for SOCs for, 15 years now. And I don't think there's ever been a more exciting time than what we're in right now. And that's a convergence of a couple of things. You know, it's the convergence of automation. It's the convergence of AI. And when you think about how all these pieces are coming together, you're going to be able to take a tier one SOC analyst and help them perform and behave more like a tier three. And that's coming through a variety of different capabilities. So when we think about things like agentic capabilities, so being able to fetch and synthesize information on your behalf, that's things like AI assistants that are helping with status updates and report writing and understanding what's happening in a particular threat, correlating threats together, saying, hey, these three different things all look the same. I think they're related to the same incident, and being able to bring that logic together. And then there's a lot of talk about fully autonomous SOC, and there's different views and different opinions about when we'll get there, if that's the right goal. But I think everybody shares the common goal of saying there's a lot of manual toil and labor that's involved in SOC still today. We're 10 plus years into this automation journey, but there's still a lot of work that gets done manually. And I think AI really has the ability to transform how we do things there.
No question. And when I talk to people that run the SOC, the big issue is not the technology and the tools. What's the number one challenge?
Yeah.
Staffing. You can't get the talent to be able to run all this stuff. And this is what I think is so exciting about this AI capability. It's going to allow entry-level staff to be able to operate at a much, much higher level, which means you open up a whole new talent pool, right?
That's right. It's not about replacing people. It's about giving them the ability to go and do other
expand
things. Every security
and amplify.
Team has a long list of things that they're not getting.
And this isn't someday, Mike.
Yeah.
This is happening now, right? And this is happening all around us.
Yeah, so when you think about how, the trends that we were just talking about, how AI is really driving the need for this new architecture and the pace that things are happening, I can't believe, it wasn't that long ago that ChatGPT first came on the scene. And you look at what's happened
months,
in the last couple of years.
Months ago,
and it's
yeah.
just like
yeah.
things are crazy in terms of the pace. And so that's why we think that it's imperative that people are thinking about this now. And the big shift that we're talking about here is going from that centralized view where you're trying to bring things to one place, whether that's your data storage, whether that's your analytics, whether that's your enforcement technologies, and rethinking that into a distributed architecture where you're using federation to pull all the pieces together. So, that's a key differentiator. And, this wasn't possible before. We're talking about things like eBPF. We're talking about this federation capability. We're talking about how DPUs are enabling smart switches. There's a lot of new things that are happening in this space. Super exciting time.
And by this distributed federated architecture you're talking about, this isn't like way out in the future. You can see bits and pieces of this now today, right?
That's absolutely.
So where would I go to actually see examples of this?
Yeah, if you're interested in seeing demos and learning more, you can come see the Splunk booth at the North Hall, booth 5445. And Tom?
You can come to the Cisco booth, which is right next to the Splunk booth. So find Splunk, you'll see Cisco in its shadow.
There you go.
Okay?
All right, thank
Thanks
you guys
very much,
so
everyone.
Much.